I believe that there is an inherent human value of democracy. It's in our blood and it moves us to action. We want to be the decision makers, the innovators, the ones whose voices matter. And when it comes to the government, most of us would like to see our voices count, but there is a major and debilitating democracy blind spot in American culture, and that's in our workplace. The majority of us are going to graduate college soon, where we'll be thrust into the workforce, destined to spend more time at our job than with our own families. Most of us will get that job, and we won't get to choose what hours of the day we work. We won't have a say in how much we get paid. We won't get to vote on our supervisors. We won't have a say in any of the changes that the company makes. We will sit down and do our job because our manager said so, and they will say so because their manager said so, and so on and on until we reach the top, where the people deciding our lives for us barely even know our name. It sounds dreary, but there's a business model that doesn't operate like that. These businesses are called worker cooperatives, and they are worker-owned businesses that are built on the foundation of democracy. In our democratic society, we should be able to work in a democratic workplace, and we should push the government to incentivize these types of businesses. In this speech, I'm going to be outlining some of the issues in our current economy, how incentivizing worker co-ops can solve these problems, and then address some of the possible concerns with a co-op economy. Now, I'm just going to introduce the issues that we have in our economy's typical business model. Again, I think that democracy is a core human value, and in our workplace, we just don't have access to it. Right now, we just kind of do whatever our companies want us to do. We can suggest new ideas or changes, but if you're in a large enough company and you don't have an executive position, your decision-making power is pretty slim. With workplace democracy, you and your coworkers have a guaranteed voice in these decisions. And when it comes to the more concrete examples, American work culture is just objectively worse than other developed countries. According to 15 years of Gallup poll data, the number of hours full-time workers have worked goes between about 45 and 47 hours per week between 2000 and 2014. What is even more extreme is that 39% of people worked over 50 hours per week. Not only that, but the U.S. is the only high-income country to have no paid parental leave, no paid sick leave, and one in four countries in the world that has no paid vacation or holiday leave. I know that I've personally had to choose between going to work sick and losing a paycheck, if I lived in any other country around the world, that just wouldn't be an issue. Another major issue is the wealth inequality in this country. The first way to look at that is through economic mobility, which is the ability for somebody who's born poor to enter the middle class. This is essentially the American dream, ironically. The 2020 Global Social Mobility Report shows that the United States ranks 27th in economic mobility, which is really low for a high-income country. Countries typically compared to the US, like the UK, Canada, or Australia, are higher ranked, so I guess that we should probably start calling it the Canadian dream, I guess. And this issue comes from the fact that American generations since the 80s make less money than their parents, which is shown here on this graph. Despite workers actually being far more productive than they have been in years past, which is here on this graph. The second way that I want to talk about inequality in America is the gap between the ultra-rich and the rest of us. If you look at this chart by UC Berkeley in 2018, you can find that the top 0.1% makes on average over $7 million per year, while the bottom 90% makes around $36,000 per year. This massive inequality has been growing since the 80s, where the majority of our GDP growth started drastically going towards the 1%. Since the 80s, their wages have increased by 229%, while the bottom 90%'s wages have only increased by 46%. Remember, our worker productivity has been increasing much faster than our wages. We're not lazy, we're just not paid what we're worth. There have been lots of proposals, many of which I agree with, as to how to fix some of these problems, but now I'm going to focus on how co-ops could solve a lot of them. I am going to define first what a worker co-op is. The basics of it is that workers become the owners of the companies that they work for. They're given stock and they're given a vote on how the company is run. Sometimes the co-op will be a direct democracy where all workers get an equal say in things like pay, benefits, and policies of the business. Other times, cooperatives will function more of a representative democracy where workers will elect board members or managers who then vote on matters of business and are held accountable by workers who elected them. This is in contrast to how our current system works, where typically executives, board members, and shareholders who either bought their way in by investing or were hired rather than elected get to make the decisions. Co-ops not only allow workers to own stock in the business that they work for, thereby making them some money off of the business's profit, but also they introduce democracy into the workplace. Employees and cooperatives, through voting, are able to advocate for themselves, and this leads to higher median wages and a more compressed wage structure, which means that people at the bottom of the company's wage ladder get paid closer to the amount of money that people at the top are paid. And in traditional companies, according to a study done in 2014, the lowest paid workers made an average of 204 times less than the highest paid workers. In cooperatives, it's only 3 to 9 times higher. Employees in cooperatives are more likely to have benefits like health insurance, paid time off, and parental leave. They also have a lot more control over what their schedule is. Co-ops mitigate economic inequality by compressing these wage structures, and they give more people things like health insurance and time off that they deserve. Employees having voting rights in their companies also just kind of means that in general, workers are happier than in traditional firms. According to a collection of studies, it's been shown that workers have more trust in their coworkers, they feel more comfortable sharing their ideas, they were more satisfied with their jobs, they felt like they had a better work-life balance, and they were less likely to quit when they worked for a cooperative. Co-ops decrease inequality, increase benefits, and just in general are a better place to work. So I've personally gotten some backlash on a few points about co-ops that I'm going to go over now in the form of kind of a question and answer. So first question is, how will workers make the right decisions in regards to business if they're not trained in that? And this is the most common concern that I run into with worker democracy. And I think it's kind of a valid point. There are some people who go to school to make these big company decisions, and people think that not anyone can do it. My response is basically, when workers own their own business, they're more likely to want to see it succeed. And this is really reflected in data. It's shown that worker co-ops are more resilient than traditional businesses. They're going to survive economic downturns when other firms won't, which shows a pretty high level of good decision making to me. The second question is, why would high-skilled workers or executives work for a co-op if they get paid less than in a traditional firm? And this is a good question because it's actually a problem. In a cooperative, the lowest wage workers would make more and executives would make less. And I have two responses to this. First, honestly, I think it's fine. A more compressed wage structure still accounts for the extra school, the longer hours, and the potentially more experience that executives have. But it also acknowledges that blue-collar workers work really hard too, and they deserve a living wage and they deserve benefits. Second, in a society with more worker cooperatives, this would just kind of become the norm for executives. And I know that's not the most satisfying answer, but they would just get used to being paid less than $1 million per year. And I think that's fine. The third question is, do you want to force businesses to become co-ops? That sounds like communism to me. And not really. While we're in the transition period, I think that instead of mandating cooperatives, governments should provide incentives for their creation, like I said before. For example, governments should give out preferential loans to people who are looking to start cooperatives instead of traditional firms. Also, we should be more open to education about cooperatives, so business students who are interested in starting a business can learn how to start a successful co-op if that's what they would prefer. There are lots of incentives that we could propose that would make a larger number of co-ops available without mandating them. Now I'm going to recap. The United States has some major economic issues. We don't have democracy in the workplace, we don't have very many benefits for workers, and we have a lot of inequality. Worker co-ops address these issues by allowing workers to advocate for themselves and own a share of their own company. There are arguments against the primarily co-op-based economy, but none that couldn't be solved through further research and policy experimentation. I think that we should be allowed to have democracy everywhere, especially in the workplace. The government, federal, state, and local should incentivize, through taxes, loans, and education, opening more worker cooperatives. I hope that I've gotten you interested in what our future could look like, and there's still a lot more to learn about the topic. In the description of the video, the top link is a review that's made by an activist about co-ops. He's put together the co-op studies from the 21st century and did a review of their contents. It discusses benefits as well as the issues with the co-ops, and I would like you to take a look and at least read the conclusion section of the document to get a broader understanding of the topics that I've brought up today. So, happy research!